Ryan was calling for unity. Unity with the nominee, Donald Trump. Now, the timing here might confuse you. It might be striking to you because just yesterday, the House Speaker said that Donald Trump's attacks on a judge were the textbook definition of racism. So what's going on? All right, some big breaking news out of the world of tennis right now. The International Campaign in Political News cutting its campaign staff in half today. Sanders, though, says he's still vowing to fight for every vote and every delegate. Though after a double-digit loss in California, he's running out of arguments to stay into the race, and many are now waiting to see if and when he will fall in
line. Senator Sanders has asked for a meeting with President Obama.
So let's talk about this and more right now with, I think, someone who might know some of the answers to those mysterious questions that Michelle posed. Joining us now, Chief Strategist for Hillary Clinton, Joel Benenson. Joel, thanks so much
thanks for being with us.
We know you know the answer to this, so we'll ask it flat out.
Exactly.
When will the president endorse Hillary Clinton? Will we hear those words out of his mouth today, perhaps, or tomorrow?
I actually don't know when he will endorse Hillary Clinton. I think in due time when he'll endorse Hillary Clinton.
One of our producers caught up to Vice President Biden on the Hill as he was there and asked him about the endorsement and what should Bernie Sanders get out now. And Vice President Biden said something to the effect of, we need to allow him to do this with grace. We need to allow him to do this. What does that look like at this point to you?
Well, look, we've said all along, Kate, that we want and need Senator Sanders. Let him take the time to have that time today with his family and his wife and his
staff. Do you think that's the timetable, like today?
Well, and then he's going to meet with the president tomorrow. Let's see how these things play out. I don't think we have to rush right now. I think he's just, you know, finished a tough race last night, and a judge who's an American and referring to his Mexican heritage, his mocking of disabled people, his ridiculous, outrageous comments on national security. This is a man who is temperamentally and totally unfit to be president of the United States. I think Bernie Sanders believes that. I believe there's an economic argument.
Pivot right there from dealing with Bernie Sanders to dealing with Donald
exactly.
Trump.
Last night, Donald Trump
spent some time trying to deal with Hillary Clinton. Right, he gave a speech last night, his victory speech after the primaries, and he made a series of charges. He talked about the emails. He talked about donations to the Clinton Foundation. Let's listen to just a little bit of sound of what Donald Trump said. It's a part of it. Your response to that?
Look, I think Donald Trump was actually trying to deal with Donald Trump last night. He's trying to distract from what has been a disastrous week or two with him. He spent
the day. What are you trying to distract from the charge that he's making?
No, say he's making racist comments.
But no response to that specific charge about Hillary Clinton at the State Department.
We're not going to deal with what he's throwing out every day when he's trying to distract from the train wreck that his campaign has become. We're going to talk about why he is unfit and unqualified for America, particularly on the economic front, and keep us safe from the challenges we face.
You just said Hillary Clinton said is temperamentally unfit to be president is rated as more honest and trustworthy than Hillary Clinton.
Look, let's see the Democratic Party consolidate here, because people are making decisions based on things that may not be asked in that poll. Which one of these people is really going to make a difference in my lives? Which one will help my kid get an education? Who'll get rid of the crushing problem candidate?
Joel Benenson, thanks so much, Joel.
Thanks for the help on the questions.
Absolutely.
Exactly.
Appreciate it.
Yeah. Exactly. These are the questions you should ask. If un-Trumpian was a word, it would be how you would best describe Mexican.
And he, out of the blue, for 10 minutes, started talking about the case, pointing out that the judge was Mexican. The judge was born in Indiana. He's of Mexican heritage. But joining us to talk about all this, CNN Politics Executive Mark Preston and Carl Higbee, a Donald Trump supporter, former U.S. Navy SEAL. Carl, Donald Trump did not apologize for those comments last night. He put out a long, lengthy statement where he said the comments were misconstrued. I still don't understand what was misconstrued. He very clearly pointed out repeatedly and without prompting that this judge was a Mexican, which is incorrect, but he kept on saying that. So what's misconstrued? What aren't we getting?
Well, I mean, look at the fact, too.
The original argument.
But, I mean, it begs the question of his Mexican heritage and his commitment to the Mexican heritage over someone like Donald Trump's candidacy. Can he be neutral? I don't think so.
So someone with Mexican heritage cannot preside
not
fairly
one that
over
is,
Donald Trump's case?
Not one that is committed.
You just said the Mexican heritage. You just actually said that not only were Donald Trump's comments not misconstrued, but you defended what a lot of people thought, including Paul Ryan, that the textbook definition of racism. You actually said that, yes, his Mexican heritage does taint his views from the
fact that what he believed. This guy.
No, his Mexican heritage is rooted in the fact that his parents are Mexican. They're not rooted in beliefs. It's a fact.
Well,
his parents are Mexican.
But that's what we're talking about, though.
All people with Mexican heritage believe in illegal immigration.
Well, not all of them. This guy does.
believe
you know that?
How does one believe in illegal immigration?
Look at his history. Look at the past. I'm a knowledge
about this.
This
was not the argument that Donald Trump originally made, though.
That's
Mark
what he brought up in relation to.
Let's weigh in.
Mark?
Well, I don't know. I mean, maybe I'll just pass it back to Carl.
I mean, look, a
couple things. One is no record that he hasn't been.
He attacked the judge's heritage. And again, it's not just me saying this. It's Paul Ryan saying this. It's the leader of the Republican Party.
It's Mark Kirk saying this.
I think we all know what exactly. I'm
Kate Baldwin. John Berman is off today. Heated divisions between voters and the establishment boiling over allegations of a rigged system, accusations of inciting violence. And this time, we're not talking about the Republican race. Now, Bernie Sanders campaign manager Jeff Weaver, he spoke out this morning as well, condemning the violence, but also accusing DNC chairwoman that you heard right there, Debbie Wasserman Schultz, accusing her specifically of working against the Sanders campaign. Listen to him. So, Senator Barbara Boxer, who has endorsed Hillary Clinton, she was at that Nevada convention. She was nearly booed off the stage. Watch this. All night as the votes came in. Let's get to the contest in just one second. But what you heard from Senator Barbara Boxer, I saw your reaction was the same as mine when she said she felt physically threatened at that event. It's an amazing statement of how this boiled over so fast.
For a United States senator to go to a...
And while not, she did say she felt better about the situation after speaking with him after that conversation. But reinforcing the point you've heard from other Democratic senators and other Democrats in general, the condemnation coming from Bernie Sanders' campaign manager doesn't seem to be going far enough for folks.
Right, and remember...
Which on the flip side, then, you wonder, like, what more do you want to hear from Bernie Sanders, right?
And we shouldn't... Ignored
last night. What happened last night, David Chalian? What clarity do we have today?
Well, listen, the clarity is this. You said Hillary Clinton is within a hundred conversations like Barbara Boxer and Bernie Sanders were just having. Mm-hmm. When do they start bringing themselves together to start figuring out how to unwind this contentious moment in the party?
Contentious moment, an amazing moment in May, let's say. Great to see you, David. Thank you very much. The votes coming in, and then also the infighting going on within the Democratic Party. What happens next? We are following it. Also ahead for us, Donald Trump. So what a difference nearly 1,200 delegates and a presumptive Republican nomination can make. Everything you just heard from Donald Trump when he was saying he was self-funding that we're talking about. This is a big announcement coming out from Donald Trump, this agreement with the RNC. What does it mean, though, for the folks at home, Alex?
Well, Kate, what it means is that if Trump can generate the kind of internet operations, data operations, the kinds of things that, Trump has talked about being able to run a cut-rate campaign because of all the media attention he gets. Media attention does not substitute for those kind of turnout programs that the party has to fund. This is a big deal, and it's going to be, it starts to disdain their corrupting influence on politics.
Yeah, it's one thing if he can get them, but then what does he say if he does get these big checks coming in? I mean, you saw it over and over again. This is one of the reasons that people loved Donald Trump, is that he can't be bought, that he's not beholden to self-interest. He's doing this all on his own. He can't really say that anymore.
Well, look, as early as early March, CNN's Sarah Murray was the first to report that Trump had said
his fundraising agreement is actually if he's going to try to repay himself to pay back those loans, because then that completely negates the self-funding concept.
Right, and that's a fair point. But again, you know, he had to be nationwide or get on board with Paul Ryan and with some other establishment Republicans and form these committees. He has...
Or how this plays out in Philly. But there was an interesting interview with another paper, not the New York Times, that Donald Trump did with the Washington Post, where they lay out that when it comes to rehabbing his image for the general election, he's not going to move on, dismiss, kind of try to distract from things that the controversial things that happened in the primary. He's going to go back to those things. He's going to take them head on, and he's going to try to explain them. Does that work?
You know, you hear about that as a strategy that he wants to explain away the things that happened in the primary. And then when he was
explaining
going
and apologizing
after,
to very
right,
different things.
And so I think that, you know, for people who are really offended by some of the things that he said, about women, and I think in general there's a big risk in trying to read into his day-to-day actions some kind of long-term strategy. Is he going to spend the next 2 weeks every day talking to a different constituency group that he may have offended and trying to win them back? That's what a conventional candidate would do. That's not something we've ever seen him try.
Yeah, and nothing conventional about it, that's for sure. Guys have got a huge concern, nonetheless.
No, absolutely. And look, if you look at the entirety of the U.S. government, even the private sector, cyber attacks are a huge pains were actually targeted here, but making very clear, not only is it already happening, but it's going to continue to happen.
Right, when you look at big companies with big IT and, you know, IT budgets that are, they're having problems stopping hackers. The federal government can't stop hackers as well as they would like to. What are the campaigns saying about this?
Well, you look at the campaign infrastructure. I think the biggest concern here is experience. They just assumed, why would we be targeted? Why would we have valuable information? Now, obviously, things are different this time around. In 2012, PsychMorgan has, and that leaves them very vulnerable.
Absolutely. All right. This is just the beginning of hearing much more about this, I'm sure. Phil, thanks so much. So, Donald Trump, he has a big meeting today. He is meeting with former Secretary of State Henry Kissinger. This comes just on the heels of for Hillary. Guys, it's great to see you. Not 53, not 51, 52.
Just 52.
Just get it right. Don't get it wrong. Kate, Bill, on this feud that ensued, we had Senator Barbara Boxer on at the top of the show. Mm-hmm. She was at that. She spoke on the stage. She tried to calm the crowd down. She says she felt physically threatened over it. That's one perspective. The other perspective coming from the Sanders campaign is they condemn the violence. That comes from Jeff Weaver. Bernie Sanders said it in a statement. They condemn any threats, I guess not violence. They condemn any threats. But, and they go on to say, the party isn't listening. They're voicing frustration over what they thought is an unfair system working against them when at this convention and beyond. But when you see what played out in Nevada, who is right and who is wrong here?
First of all, establishment pulls together. They make their own rules, and somebody coming from the outside has, is an uphill fight.
So, assuming
we move forward to 9 more contests.
Assuming the party works it out, which, to be honest, today it is not clear that the party will. You did not see the dismissive face on Bill Press when I said that right there. Today, at this moment, it is unclear where things go from here. But Bernard, Hillary Clinton, regardless, mathematically, it is very likely she will be the Democratic nominee. She needs Bernie Sanders supporters when she moves into the general election. Going forward, how does she respond to not necessarily what happened in Nevada, but the frustration that Bill is talking about to try to get them on board? Because it sure doesn't look, from like what happened in Nevada, like they're close to it yet.
I absolutely agree. And I think he deserves the right to be able to bring that voice to Philadelphia. However, he also has a responsibility to unite this party with the eventual nominee who will be Hillary Clinton. I think it was a crisis of leadership from attacks and the violence in Nevada, as he did at the attacks and violence that have, it's a couple bad apples down there. But at the same time, he could have risen above, shown himself to be a true leader, working in the interest of the party, and more importantly, Bernie Sanders is an independent. At the end of the day, he switched to the Democratic Party just months before he began his candidacy. So at the end of the day, is the system rigged against outsiders? To some extent, yes, but this is a nomination for the Democratic Party. I think the challenge for Hillary Clinton is going to be to attract independents, many of whom have been Sanders supporters.
You're shaking your head, though. You don't think Bernie Sanders needs to do more?
I think Bernie is...
Couldn't you come out and said exactly what you just said?
The statements that I've seen from him have been pretty strong, right? But I want to come back, you know, I don't know, again, what do you want? There are 9 more contests. See this? This is my absentee ballot. Now and then, let's keep on.
Bill Press will be leading in that song. Bernard, I don't know if he's going to be on tune with him. We'll see.
We will.
We will. Just trust us, Bill says. It's all going to be okay. Bill, Bernard, thanks, guys. I really appreciate it. Thank you. So coming up, ever wonder what it's like to be a... So he was in the trenches with Donald Trump during some of the campaign's most challenging days. And Robert is here with me right now. It's great to see you.
Thanks for having me. It's been a long time.
I feel like maybe we saw you in Iowa. That's the last time I saw you. How much time and what kind of access did you get with Trump for this piece?
Yeah, it was over a period of 5 weeks. I flew on his plane 4 times.
As close as one can come. It seemed, from reading your piece, it seemed that you had a similar experience with Donald Trump than we've heard others who were getting to know Donald Trump. He's someone in private and seems someone different in public.
Sure. Yeah. I mean, you see him in campaign rallies, Kate, and he's very voice. He's dealt with the media for over 30 years. I mean, everyone now acknowledges him as a master of the media. Yeah. But that doesn't mean just saying outrageous things. It means knowing when.
One incident you write about is when he was retweeted that demeaning photo comparing Heidi Cruz and Melania Trump. And about that, you wrote this.
Particular point in time, he had no reason to feel any animus. This was on March the 23rd. He had just put out a photo, a tweet of Melania Cruz and seemed to be Melania Trump and seemed to be disparaging her. So this was his means of counterpunching, which he did later that evening after saying goodnight after dinner.
And it just seems to speak to what a lot of folks are saying now, that even if he has this campaign staff, Donald Trump, He plans his PR. He handles his PR. Donald Trump is the man at the top.
Yeah, you know, I've covered a lot of campaigns, Kate. You often hear a campaign manager say, oh, the million interview requests, and Trump himself decides which ones he's going to take. And sometimes it's someone who is a liberal's opinion.